To sponsor food, and we need spaces that can accommodate 100 people. Follow SMByyc on Twitter, and if you're tweeting today, you can use the hashtag SMByyc. Any questions so far? Is all good? Good. We also have social media breakfast in Edmonton, which has happened on the last Friday of every month. So, anybody ever been to Melrose downtown? And does anybody remember that that little time period in 2004 when the Calgary Flames were on a streak to the Cup, and we didn't actually win it, but downtown was a little bit of a big party for a while? Anybody remember that? I think I recognize some of you from there. So, there's some pictures, yeah, probably still floating around, I'm sure. What we have today is Tony Johansson, who started with Melrose just after the Flames had their little run with the Cup. And so he's been with Melrose since 2004. He's pioneered, really, social media in the bar and restaurant industry. So a lot of social media digital communications that you see with restaurants here today have come from Tony. He's built a team of marketing pros. He's just all around a good guy. So you can find Tony on Twitter at tjohan. Melrose is melrosecalgary.com is the website. Melrose Red Mile is their Twitter account, and facebook.com/melrosecalgary. Tony also runs with his wonderful wife, Vox Pop Media, which helps small businesses and connect to digital communication and social media. So you can find them at voxpopmedia.com and Twitter handle Vox Pop. So I'm out of here, Tony. Oh yeah, big love.
How's everyone doing? So it is actually, it's at voxpop_media for the Twitter handle. But thank you everyone for inviting me here today.
I feel honored to be here and talk in front of you. And the response on Twitter has been nothing short of phenomenal with everyone and their kind tweets. So I'm here today to talk to you about Melrose and social media and how we've basically leveraged it and used it as a small business and what it's done for us. The best way I can explain this to you guys is to basically tell you where we came from and why we got to the point where we wanted to use the social media platforms. So that's what I'm going to do. Okay, so before we get going, I just want to share a little bit about Melrose, a little bit of our past history and who we are. One of the biggest things that I see as the marketing manager in the 7 years that I've been there is everyone thinks that we're a corporation, we're a chain, there's a whole bunch of us, when that's actually not the case. We are a standalone, independently run, family-run restaurant. We just celebrated our 20th year in the Calgary community, and the best thing I can say to explain, it's okay, just one of the things that I like most about Melrose is the fact that it is family run and operated. It's not every day that you come into work and you see the owner's wife. It's not uncommon to see the owner's mother show up around 9 a.m. who's about 70 years old, I think. Is that right, Dave? 70 years old, and without fail, every day she's there, she goes into the back and she does prep and starts getting some of the food ready. Things like our ginger beef, which we are sort of known for, is actually a family recipe. There's only two people in the world who know the actual recipe to that ginger beef. One of them is the owner's father, who passed away a couple years ago. But he passed that recipe down to their nephew, who is the only one who knows how to make it. So I guess we're in trouble if something happens to him. But they built a business. They started in 1991. Year after year, they saw increased sales. When it started out, what you see today is not what the Melrose was that started 20 years ago. It was just a small bar side on the top level and the restaurant. They expanded by creating that patio that you see today, which is, I think it holds well over 100 people. And then on the bar side, they dug down and started making multi-levels to facilitate functions and things like that. They kept going, and being the great operator that the owner is, they were just always really on the ball, on top of things. He was considered a market leader in our industry, always pushing, doing new things, playing with technology all the time. So it was kind of something that he was already known for. And when 2004 happened, that was kind of a big turning point for Melrose, because it put Melrose on the map. So if you want to click ahead. So this is actually footage shot directly from the rooftop of Melrose during 2004 and the pandemonium that was the Red Mile. A lot of media outlets from across Canada started filming us. We even had ESPN come and shoot from the rooftop to US feeds because it was Tampa Bay. So we gained a lot of national exposure. We were in the paper almost every other day because of the Red Mile phenomenon. And if you want to click ahead one more time. The one thing about it was, a lot of people said we created the Red Mile, which really wasn't the case. It was a spontaneous thing that happened. People were there to celebrate the fact that the flames went. What Melrose did right was they were ready and they were able to capitalize on that momentum when it happened. And the owner did a great job of doing that. So that's kind of why, for whatever reason, we ended up being an epicenter for that whole thing. And it really put us on the map. After the Red Mile happened, we had a lot of tourists that were coming to see Melrose because it was a destination point for something that they'd seen on TV. So here's the timeline that I kind of did after 2004, because we weren't on social media as of yet. 04-05, as a lot of you know, was the hockey lockout. So that was kind of we hit a really big high and then kind of nothing, because it was all revolved around hockey and the Flames, the energy that they generated for the city. So what ended up happening was we were still very busy. People were anxious, but everyone wanted to see that, go back and experience what they experienced during the Flames playoff run. In 2006 is when hockey fever returned. So I started at the tail end of 2004. I spent a whole year kind of learning about the business. Not a lot really happened. We just kind of went day to day and did the same marketing pieces that we always did. So we were in print. The owner's very, very tight with his money because we are a small business, and that's one of the other things too. We don't have a huge budget when it comes to marketing, and which leads down later on down the road why we ended up using the social media tools, because it was something that fit our budget really. But so moving forward, hockey fever returned. Along with the hockey fever was 2006, when the economic boom kind of started to happen. And unemployment was at almost an all-time low kind of thing. In our industry, hospitality, it was almost impossible to find people to hire starting in 2006 to about 2008. A lot of people started bringing in foreign workers to actually fill those roles. And what actually started happening was it kind of started that climb. So 2008 happened, competition started opening up because it was really easy to open a restaurant because the customer service started to slide right across the city. And you could make money hand over fist. You could have bad service and people would still keep coming back. That just was, for whatever reason, seemed like the mentality that was happening in Calgary at the time. Fast forward to 2009, that's when kind of cue the crash. Stuff started slowing down, the market declined, customer service started to slowly make that comeback. It was no longer an employee market, it became an employer market again. And then 2010, we find ourselves kind of riding this wave up. We believed our own hype that we were this great grand place. You get swept up a little bit in all the media that comes along with things. So 2010 comes and sales are dipping right across the board for the entire market. And we took a look at what do we do, how do we get back to where we were. We found ourselves no longer being industry leaders. We found ourselves kind of in the middle of the pack. A lot of new players were in the market, completely new landscape and new competition. So that was when I sat down and decided it was time to do a rework and figure out where do we go from here. Like I said, the landscape had changed. What we ended up doing in January of 2010 was a gut check. And we did a SWOT analysis. We found out our strengths, our weaknesses, the opportunities and threats within our environment. And while we were doing that, I kind of started to notice reviews and online, and a bit of online negative sentiment. So here's a couple of examples of one of the first Yelp reviews that we we ever saw. So it goes, I never really have been a fan of Melrose. Seems like a place for yuppie, uptight individuals to congregate and talk about all the other yuppies in the bar. I've never felt comfortable having drinks or dinner in this place because I don't really feel like I belong. Seems like everyone in the bar, including the staff, is judging me and thinking the same thing. I am, you don't belong here. It's just not a very welcoming environment for me. It goes on and on. There's actually another one. And again, I fail to see the attraction in this establishment, on and on and on. If you have to go at the very bottom, use the left side of the premises, far away from the withering pheromone fest on the right as possible. So, very positive stuff, eh? So, this was some of the stuff that we saw, and I kind of took notice of it, and didn't really know what to think of it. We started seeing more of it. Facebook was fairly popular. We were actually in the middle of trademarking rights for Heart of the Red Mile, and with the trademark lawyers, I had to do a lot of investigation and make sure that other people weren't using the trademark, things like that. So you'd go on Facebook, which was still relatively new back then, I guess. No, probably not, but we were using Facebook, but we didn't really know what we were doing with it because everyone else in our industry was using Facebook. Everyone was using MySpace. It was just nothing but another place to broadcast, really. So we noticed that people were creating their own groups and doing things and using the brand because there was a group of people that really loved Melrose. Initially, our response was, oh, what are they doing? That's our brand. Like, you can't create a group based around our brand. Some of the groups were things like liquid panty remover, stuff like that. It was really bad stuff, to be quite honest with you. But anyway, so we looked at social media, and what I realized was it was an untouched toolbox in our industry. And those that had it didn't know what they had, including us. Back to that previous slide, it was supposed to bounce back there. But when we did that SWOT check, I started looking at what happened during the last recession. How did some restaurants really tackle that, and what kind of marketing tactics did they use to get back to their business that they had before? And what I found was relationship marketing was kind of a big thing that kept popping up. So I kind of researched relationship marketing, what is this thing from the 70s, and one day I found this article about relationship marketing that started talking about social media. And then from there I kind of started looking a little bit more about social media. I found the Foresters website was talking a lot about it, saying this is the wave of the future. I didn't really understand it at the time, but I just kind of kept looking at it, started showing up to events like these. In fact, I ended up doing a one-day social media boot camp here in Calgary with the owner and the director of operations. And that was kind of what really opened our eyes, that one-day boot camp. And that's when we realized that this was kind of the way to go. And with all the negative sentiment that was happening, for me, it was something that really never sat right because of what I said at the very beginning. Melrose is a family-run, operated business. You're never going to find a more caring family than those people that own it, the Leong family. They do a lot of things, they just don't make it public for charities and things like that. The owner's father, because they immigrated to Canada, I can't remember, in the 40s I think it was, but he kind of had this thing where he would always try to find a way to bring someone over from China to kind of give them a better life, but they never really talked about that. So he did a lot of that in the Chinese community. So things like that is what I thought Melrose was. That's what Melrose meant to me. So to see things like we don't feel welcome in our establishment, the withering pheromone fest on the other side, just never sat right. So for me, I looked at social media as a tool that we could tell our side of our story and reintroduce our story and who we were to the Calgary market, which was locally independent human. And again, it fit my budget. So how we got started. 2010 was a learning year. We kind of spent the year really listening, learning, watching, paying attention to what other people were doing. Because our industry wasn't really doing it, what I did was I turned my attention to other industries that were doing it. And I guess I'm a big believer that to innovate, you need to look outside of where you are, because if you're just looking in your day-to-day, it's everyone's doing the same thing, especially in our industry. I mean, it's not uncommon I don't know if you've ever been down to Vegas. A lot of the concepts and ideas that are down in Vegas get lifted and brought up to other cities. It kind of all starts there in the hospitality and restaurant industry. So for me, it was definitely to look outside the box and see what was happening. And again, we initially started our journey by broadcasting on Twitter, just talking to no one. It was crickets because you didn't know if anyone was listening or paying attention to you. So after doing that for a while, I kind of went back to the drawing board and said, okay, this really isn't working. We need to draft a strategy that tied into our business goals. So we went back to the board, we looked at all the platforms and decided what's the purpose for being here and how do we achieve those objectives. So community was something that, again, was very important to us, and we needed to find a way to integrate that together. So we sat down, had a major powwow, myself, the owner, and the director of operations, and really looked at ways that we could connect back to the community. And basically it came down to bringing some of those things that the family was already doing to the forefront and giving back to charities, helping people out with things that they needed. So that wasn't without a lot of hard work and convincing of the ownership, because social media in itself, the concept of you give, and eventually it will come back is kind of counterintuitive to a lot of business minds. So that was why this next one is building our community, a leap of faith, because I had to really convince ownership to let me go and run with it. So before I got that buy-in, I had to do a lot of trial and error and figure how to get people to do things. So the big thing was we started seeing responses when we paid attention to people's needs, not ours. And I think that was really the turning point. So I'll say it again. We started paying attention to other people's needs, not ours. So the first time we gave back was actually an individual here in Calgary on Twitter. Some of you in this room may know her, Jillian Walker. We noticed that she was competing in a contest called, I think it was like the next HR top student or something like that. And she was asking people for votes. So what we did was we said, okay, well, let's try to help her win this contest. So we would tweet out for her, and we ended up getting into a dialogue with her and talking back and forth, and she just seemed really appreciative that we did that. And it just seemed like a good thing. It was the first time we really had constant communication with someone that was actually paying attention and following us. So what ended up happening was one late night I was on Twitter, and I saw a tweet that came from her saying, I need a poster maker, I need a venue, and I need an event person to help me out. So I tweeted her because I thought to myself, well, we have all those things. And I sent her that tweet and said, how can we help? We ended up having a meeting. She came in and she sat down with me and she said, I don't know if you've been following me very closely or not, but I've recently had something, a scare that happened to me. So she actually had a breast cancer scare, and but it came back negative and she's okay. But it scared her and she wanted to do something to give back to that community, to all those people that helped her in her journey. So she wanted to do a fundraiser. So what we ended up doing was helping her do that fundraiser for breast cancer. I went to the owner and said, I think we should try something different that we don't normally do. And basically we gave food and drink and everything for her at cost so that she had a really low overhead to actually run this event and kind of yield as much back in funds as possible. So we'd never done anything like that. That was really the turning point, because we did something for someone else and didn't really look for anything back in return. What we ended up finding was she became a brand champion for us. She started talking to people without us prompting her to do that, without us asking for anything. And she was directing people to us, saying, if you need help, come see these guys. They'll help you. So that's when we realized, okay, we got to replicate this, because this seems to be doing something for us. Someone else is marketing our business, and we're not paying them to do that. So the next step was to get to know people. How did we get to know people? We started coming to events like this. We started taking part in any community initiative thing that we could do. And we looked at our business and what did we have to offer people, which was our venue. We could do good pricing. And all that was, we could offer that all for nothing to people, all based on the faith that it would come back to us. And this is really where I started to understand the concept of social equity. The more you give back, you're just building up your bank of social equity. And when the time does come for you to ask of your community, they're there and ready to give back and support you. So that's kind of a quick rundown of how we got to where we were. Now I'm just going to talk a little bit about what we do and the things that have worked for us. So engagement is really the key for me. We're very active as a team. When it comes to Twitter, it's not one individual running it. There's three of us that run it right now. Actually, David in the back corner over there. Haley, who's running the laptop for us. And then I just got to give a shout out to someone else who used to be part of the team, Mrs. Allie Simpson, right in the front here. So the reason I wanted to bring up them before I actually get into the engagement was because they were they're a big part of why Melrose is what it is online. I guess the one thing is I was doing something different within our organization. A lot of our staff thought I was just sitting on Facebook and Twitter wasting my time and wondering why I'm getting paid. And I was always talking to everyone about it and saying, hey, we have to do this, we have to do this. So I kind of looked like that one Yahoo on his soapbox all by himself screaming and yelling. But these three actually kind of rallied behind me. And they became my champions within the organization and started talking and spreading exactly what I was saying to everybody else, which has kind of multiplied within our organization. Our entire management team will have their own Twitter accounts, and they're actively tweeting and talking to people. So while we monitor Twitter almost 24/7, sometimes I almost don't have to because the other guys are on Twitter paying attention to what's happening when they're on the floor. So just wanted to share that little insight with you. But back to the engagement. So small business, this is one thing that I've heard from a lot of people, is that we don't have time and we don't have money to do it. So for me, I think engagement's the fun part because you're only constrained by the time part, but you're also only constrained by your imagination and with what you can come up with. It's not budget. There are ways to find how to do things. Like I said, we're a small independent company. We don't have a ton of budget. We can't afford to go create our own commercials. We can afford radio, but we don't do it as much. It's just something that we haven't seen work for us as well. Not to say that we won't do it again, though. But we basically define our success by how well we know our community, not by followers, likes, or views. So I guess with that comment there, I'm just saying it's not about the number of followers, the number of likes, how many times a video has been viewed. Those are lame metrics to kind of follow and go off of. The metrics that we go after are how many times do we talk with one individual? How many times, how deep have we taken this relationship and built it? Because the more we do these relationships, the more we're actually building brand champions for ourselves, because it's just the more you care about people, the more they come back. And a good example of that is actually two people standing in the corner talking to each other right now, Donna and Kevin. It kind of started as a funny thing. So we had this brunch. We had just launched a new brunch menu. Donna was showing up for meetings for Slave Lake. One of the things that we put ourselves out there and said we'll provide the venue for it at no cost. So there was a committee that ended up happening, would meet every Sunday. And Donna started coming and she just absolutely fell in love with the waffles, correct? So she started tweeting pictures about it, talking, and in her feed she was always promoting the Melrose brunch and how awesome the waffles were. And that, again, goes back to a brand champion going out and doing your marketing for you. She kept doing it, and then I can't remember, I think it was Allie who started talking to Kevin one day on Twitter, and they started talking about brunch. And then Kevin started saying, okay, I guess I better come down for the brunch. He came down and then fell in love with the brunch. Yeah? So from there, those two were always talking about brunch, talking about brunch. And then fast forward to another event that we ended up doing to help the community was Hollapalooza, where again, we provided the venue and some of our resources and expertise to help execute that event. And again, a committee was drawn up to meet every Sunday and talk about how to make the event take off and everything like that. And what happened was after that event happened, no one was meeting anymore, and I think it was Donna who said, let's all just meet for brunch for the heck of it. And then I think Mitch actually showed up and started tweeting about it that day. And actually, if you skip again, again, and here we go, the Breakfast Club, and then one more. So here's back to the Brunch Club is what they've actually called themselves, and it's a hashtag that happens on Twitter, and we actually don't even know when they show up. We just we'll see the hashtag start forming a couple days before, and that's when we know that, okay, we better reserve some room for them in the bar side. So here's the review. It says, thanks to some new Twitter friends, I have been spending some time at Melrose. I'm there on our Sunday breakfast club and other social events like Third Tuesdays, Calgary Bloggers, and more. The staff at Melrose are terrific. Notice the capital T. They take good care of all their customers, new and old, friendliest bunch of people around. Who would have thought of going to Melrose for brunch? So I guess what I'm trying to illustrate here is that the power of social media has turned that negative sentiment around. Not totally. In restaurant and hospitality, there's people that are going to hate you, people that are going to love you. You're never going to be able to make all customers satisfied. That's just the nature of the beast. But our Yelp score when we first started, I think, was at a 1 star. After 2.5 years, we're now at a 3.5 star, which I'm quite comfortable with. Because I want people to be able to go on Yelp and see that we're human, we make mistakes. It's not a 5 star, it's not perfect, and we're okay with that. Just to talk about the Yelp platform a little bit, we actually do go through the business account, and every single post that happens, we do our best to make sure that we respond to it, negative or positive, always thanking people for their input. And when we deal with negative sentiment online, that's our big key, is just to say thank you for letting us know. 9 times out of 10, some of the things that are brought up to us online that's negative, we actually never thought of it from that point of view. So rather than getting upset and mad about it and saying, oh, well, they just hate us, we try to embrace it and see how we can better our business. And it has worked for us. Like I said, on Yelp, we've really moved that needle from a 1 star to a 3.5. And I think we're sitting at over 40 reviews as a business right now. Yelp itself is really growing in the Calgary community. I think it was a year and a half, 2 years ago, they just added a community manager, who's someone that we reached out to and started talking to and seeing how we can help that community and help out. So, but yeah, it's a crazy thing. This group here, we love them to death. They promote our brunch, and to the point that it ended up being in the Calgary Sun a couple of weeks ago. There was an article about the brunch club and how everyone loves it. And the review was, the actual food review wasn't the greatest, but we thanked them for that. And there's a couple points in there that actually help us, because from a back behind the scenes standpoint, there's a couple things we want to change. And when we get certain information, it does give us firepower to go to ownership and say, we need to change this aspect of what we're doing. And this is why, because we have this feedback. The one thing that we love about social media is we used to do surveys. It was my job to conduct an independent survey of Melrose, of the patrons that came through. It was a big waste of time and cost a lot of money for us to do. And at best, people were just paying us compliments because we were there, and not really being honest with us, just saying, yeah, everything's good, good, good. Social media is completely different, because people online are not afraid to say exactly what they think. We will often have instances where if someone has a complaint, they won't tell anyone in the restaurant. We don't even know about it, but they'll go online and tell people about it. So that's why we make it a mandate to make sure we try to grab these people and talk to them, find out what happened, because it betters us as a business. People don't always respond. We get about 50% redemption on people talking back to us. So can you click back? Okay, so here's some of the things that I just wanted to show as examples of how you don't need a big budget. You can do things on the cheap and still achieve some great things. So if you want to click forward, I don't know if you can. Can you hold that up to the speaker? A little closer. Closer. Closer to the speaker. So yeah, so that was a flash mob that we did January of last year. Ali was a big part of that. And that didn't cost us, I think it cost us $300 to do that. How we did it was we put it out there, we went to local choir groups, and as you see that was Rev 52, who's a local choir group. It was just perfect timing. They had a concert coming up and they wanted to promote it. And they, like us, didn't have a big budget, but they had their talent, which was to sing. So we brought them in, we choreographed a flash mob, and then we just filmed it using cameras that we had and edited it together. It's not the greatest of productions, but it gets that feeling across. It's one of our most viewed YouTube videos, but what I love about this video is that I look at the other metric and the like bar. There's a lot of likes on it, and there's a lot of comments about it. It's somewhat of a polarizing video. I guess not everyone is a fan of that song, but that's not a bad thing to have something polarizing online. So this here, can you just review it back? Hit it play again. Yeah, did everyone hear that or no? Okay, go ahead and... Oop.
Hey, Dan McGuire. We saw your tweet last night about us feeling like they're sure. Well, if you can't see them, join them. That's a little CCL. I think I see a UFO.
And then play the next one. I'll just do them all in a shot. And the audio is actually off on that one. I'll explain this one. Okay, so this guy here is Chef Kukathama. He is a $20 puppet, but he has his own personality and his own everything. We treat him like he's part of the team, especially in the online world. I guess it's a little bit of storytelling on our part. What we use the puppet for is another level of engagement. It's one thing to send a tweet to someone and say happy birthday, which we did for a very long time. When we saw someone in our followers that it was their birthday, we'd tweet them, say happy birthday, come in and have a drink, or we'll buy you a birthday cookie on us. We decided to take it to another level because we noticed competition started doing what we were doing. And this is how Chef Kukathama was born. What the power of him is that he can also handle not just birthday tweets, he can handle negative comments as well. Which that one about the Jersey Shore is actually us responding to a negative comment about Melrose. And our take on it was, we thanked them, we said we appreciate that, but then we're also trying to make fun of ourselves because we're just also trying to display that we're human. Hey, we get it. Friday, Saturday nights, it's a different crowd that comes from Melrose than it is every other day of the week. And then we also try to personalize it. So the comment at the end where the puppet says, I think I see a UFO, actually goes back to some mention that was in the person's Twitter feed. And we do that all the time. Joel Olendeska, I don't think he's here today, his birthday tweet, he was talking about how many people were born in the world and something that was happening on Twitter where you could tell how many people were born, how many people in the world were there when you were born and how many people are in the world now. So, because he was talking about it right around his birthday, we threw it into the tweet and invited him down. And then this very last one here that you can't hear because the audio is off is actually us talking to an influencer on social media. This is actually a video that goes to Mike's Bloggity Blog. Do you want to come up and do it, Dave? what he said. So, basically, he says this hat is heavy as he's lifting himself up off the ground. And he says, at Mike's Bloggity Blog, we want to congratulate you on 5 years of your blog and being one of Canada's top entertainment blogs. You did prove everybody right that Canada does need entertainment blogs online. He actually came back and talked to me after, and he said that meant a lot to him, that someone actually noticed that. We pulled that part about the entertainment blog and Canada needing it directly off his blog and his about, where he states why he does what he does. So we find that this takes it deeper, the engagement, and builds relationships better. We had never actually talked to Mike in person. After that video, he started talking to us, and actually we did a joint venture together where there was a core mini program that was social media run by the core downtown, where four media outlets had to compete against each other to who could get the most photos posted of the core mini for that week. I think it was Amp Radio, the Calgary Herald, and CTV, and then Mike. He came to me and said, I'm a little guy, I'm a standalone, they're all these big corporations that have extra people helping them, but I'd like to prove people that social media works. So he was speaking my language, independent with independent, and we banded together and helped him, because what we did was, for the week that he had it, anyone that had a picture of the Core Mini could actually come into the restaurant and show that photo, and we'll get 25% off their bill. And on our end, when we started pushing it out through Twitter, we actually called it a coupon, like Mini Cooper coupon, Groupon. So that was just another example of taking it and going deeper. Now we talk to Mike, not all the time, but we do see him from time to time, and I know him when we're in public, and I guess that's the other secret sauce for us, why we become successful. You can do everything online, you can build engagement, and it's great. It does go far. But for us as a restaurant, the second people step through our doors, it's getting up there and putting a human face in front of it and reinforcing that, hey, we care about you. Thank you for coming in. Thank you for your business. That's a big one for us, is always thanking people and making sure that they know that there's a human on the other end of that Twitter feed. Sometimes it's tough talking to a logo, but we do our best to really humanize that. So I guess a little bit about what's next. I hope that kind of covers what Melrose does and how we do things. One thing that I guess I've noticed in the last 3 to 4 months is, in our industry at least, more and more of the restaurants and bars are actually hopping on and really know what they're doing now. It's no longer just broadcasting. There's people talking to people and establishing relationships and building their own communities. And I guess moving forward, I think that social media is going to be a way that we all have to do business. It's just the way we're communicating as a society. It's one of those things. It's a disruptive force where it's changing the way things have been done in the past. Radio, print, and all that are having a hard time adjusting, but there are groups that are doing good things. I mean, I look at the Calgary Herald, and I think they've got Tumblr, they got Twitter, they got you name it, they got it. So they're adapting. Yellow Pages is a good example of someone adapting. I don't know how many people use the phone book still. Yeah. So they had to adapt, or else they would end up like Kodak and be gone, or Blockbuster. So anyways, back to what I was talking about here. Social media is important, but what's going to end up becoming even more important, and why I think businesses need to get on it, is that as more and more people are trying to talk and talk, even Twitter right now, from 2 years ago to what it is today, it's this fire hose of information that's coming your way so fast, it's hard to keep up with what people are actually saying. I know 2 years ago, if I was following someone, I could generally find their tweets and see what they're saying. Now, I'll talk to people and they're like, didn't you see what I put on Twitter? And I don't see it, because there's just so much stuff coming through, that river of information. It's getting so big right now. So what's going to end up happening is that for us as a business, it's no longer about trying to get new people through the door. It's about retaining what you have and keeping those people and really working the word of mouth angle and getting them to promote your business and bring the new people in. So it's all about retention, and the big commodity that's going to happen as you move forward is going to be community. So the bigger your community, the stronger you're going to be, the more you take care of your community, the better off you're going to be. Because there's other groups that are going to try to steal your community away and try to outdo them and wow them. There's lots of businesses that will try the whole retweet to win kind of thing. I don't think that's the way, because then the consumer expects that all the time. And then you're stuck in that cycle where you're constantly giving stuff away. So that's why we try to do things that matter, that mean something to people, that put a smile on people's face. Things like the puppet, things like the flash mob, and appreciating comments and things that people say to us. So yeah, that's kind of that. That's really it. Nothing special. You guys have questions? Any questions? I mean, this is, I'm an open book up here. Go ahead.
How are you using Facebook?
Yeah, Facebook. So we are using Facebook. We post maybe once or twice a day. We try to get on there. For us, at least for me personally, here's a funny thing. 2.5 years ago, I wasn't on social media. I was actually anti-social media. The privacy concerns, things like that. But then a funny thing happened to me personally. So I'll back up and answer that. But what happened to me was someone opened up a Facebook account under my name with a bunch of stuff that was slanderous to me and I took offense to. After that, I realized, well, not being on there is not a good thing because that's my name, that's my reputation on there. If someone sees that, that's not good. So you have to be there, even for your own personal brand, to protect yourself because you need to be able to talk back and say, that's not me. But so Facebook's been one thing I've never really quite loved. I've just found it, for us as a restaurant, it's been a little bit more difficult to build that engagement. Twitter's been faster, Twitter's instant. But we are doing it. We do post things. We run polls, things like that. One thing that's really happened for Facebook and Twitter, when we started, it was just a way to tell our story, but it's evolved since then. It's also become a customer service tool in that we book reservations online through Facebook, through Twitter, deal with customer complaints. It's really become, I guess, our defense. So when for customer service, we're always there to protect the brand, talk to the brand, and catch those instances where we need to make up for customer service like you do in the bar and restaurant industry. Things like the puppet, I guess, would be offense, where we are really going after people and trying to really engage them. Does that kind of answer a little? Not really? Yeah. Yeah, well, and we do the advertising. We've done, we did that way back when too, before we were actually really active on social media. It works. I know some other people that say it's been a lot more effective for them, the advertising. Yeah, and that's one thing that so I guess in the Vox Pop thing that I do talk to a lot of how that even started was people started coming to me asking me how did you guys do that with Melrose? So my wife and I turned around and did it. But I guess to answer that question and any business that comes up to me and says, well, why do I'm on Facebook and Twitter, my first response back to is why. To me, each platform is completely different. Each platform is a community that has different elements to it and reacts different to how you're on there. Even YouTube is a community in itself that a lot of people don't realize that they talk to each other. It's similar to, I guess, MySpace was a few years ago. But yeah, I mean, that goes back to our strategy. We sat down and when we built our strategy, we pulled out the platforms that we thought we would be on. Facebook's one of those ones where I think almost everyone does have to be on it. I mean, there's 650 million users on there. But it's just about finding an engagement strategy that works for you, and I mean, you can make it whatever you want. One thing we used to post an entire gallery of photos from events, and it was like no one was paying attention. We've revamped, and we only post like one or two photos now from an event, but we try to make those photos be as engaging as possible or mean something. Breakfast Club is another example. Haley one day went up and snapped a photo of the Breakfast Club, went downstairs, put it on Facebook, and said, "Hey guys, thanks for coming." Everyone liked the photo, everyone started talking about it, it just kind of took on a life its own. So with Facebook, I find that when we do something, we check our insights, we see what the engagement level is, and then if it's good, then we keep going down that path and just transform it and weave it and make it something different, but similar to what it was that initially got that. If it didn't work, we just switch and try a different gear, which is something that I love about the internet. That you can't do in the print mediums and things like that. You can track your analytics, you can see what's working, and it's quick, it's real time. You basically can fail faster. If you run a coupon drop, it's gonna take a few weeks for you to figure out, did that coupon drop work? Did we target the right areas? If we do a coupon drop through Twitter, like we did with the Mike's Bloggity thing, that was a 1 week turnaround. We knew 2 or 3 days in whether it was working or not because we we stack it up with the bills and things like that and see how many people are actually bringing the photo in. So, anyone? So Foursquare is something that we've had our eye on for quite a while. I guess it's part two. we have plans to actually get a lot more aggressive on there. Because the Calgary market, no one was really doing it. It's not that I didn't feel the need that we should do it, I just was kind of keeping it in my back pocket for some ammunition when the other guys start kind of copying the things that we do. So we do plan to do that, and again, Foursquare is another, I mean, it's a whole community, people talking back and forth to each other there too, so we'll probably be doing the check-in offers and things like that with Yelp and with Foursquare moving forward, and a few other things that, ideas that we got. Personally, I think it was constant. It was just so when we did that rework, that SWOT analysis, after that we came out and when I sat down with the owner and the director of operations, it was, we need to get back to who we are. And I think social media did that. With that whole wave of 2004 and the boom and everything, we started spending money on silly things, like a T-Rex. I don't know if anyone's seen that. It's a hybrid motorcycle car that's just a wow factor. It was a promotional vehicle for going to events. It's cool, and it does get a lot of talking, but a lot of money for something different. So things that weren't really our brand, that were more like just things that we did were fun, that weren't our core. Our core is we're food, we're service, we're a great place to come. Social media is bringing us back to that and trying to reach to the community. And so I think it brings us back to who we were as a brand. Anyone else? Yep. Sorry.
So with Melrose Red Mile, you're having your Twitter handle.
Yeah.
And the history of the Red Mile, how is Melrose going to evolve beyond that reputation or that image? Will it change the Twitter handle soon?
And that's a good point, because I wrestled with that, because the negative sentiment did have a little bit to do with the Red Mile. In the community, at least where we're situated on 17th Ave, there's the actual community of Mount Royal, and then there's the Beltline and everything. A lot of people in the community weren't happy with the Red Mile, and I don't blame them. I mean, they can't get to their homes, they can't get around. Like it was there were challenges with it. So there are people that don't like the Red Mile, that don't like everything that happened, I mean, the girls and all that stuff. So we were looking, do we dump that, what do we do? It is trademarked. We did a website, we relaunched it last year, and before we took it public, we actually invited a bunch of people from Twitter down and got them to play with the website, because it was real-time feedback and people would tell us what their opinions were. The initial website had nothing really Red Mile-ish. We took the Red Mile stuff out. And the biggest thing that we got from that little focus group was, where's the Red Mile? So while it has negative connotations to it, there's also a lot of positives, because there is another side of the crowd that really loved what happened there. You look at that actual incident, I almost think it was a coming out party for Calgary, to the nation as well. And us displaying, even now you look at, you compare it to the Blue Mile, you compare it to Vancouver. We're held as a standard that we showed that we could party and have fun, and the most that happened was some public nudity. So does that kind of answer it, Mitch?
Yeah, okay.
What's that?
Don't forget the couple that made love with the
camera. Oh yeah, that's true. Yeah, that was a good photograph. Anyone else? Okay, well, thank you for your time. Appreciate it. Again, feel free to talk to us online. We love the engagement. We love talking to people. If you're ever in Melrose, send us a tweet. We'll come up and say hi if we're here. So, and again, yeah, just another shout-out to Melrose. Without Haley and Dave and people like Allie who were formerly there, I don't think we could do it. Social needs to live through the organization. Moving forward, I think everyone has to be a part of it. It can't just be one person. Because if one person leaves, that champion is gone, the whole thing will die. So.
Thanks so much for sharing that, those insights and how social media isn't just about getting on social media, it's about having a strategy and tying your social media strategy to each of your business goals. So let's. There's going to be a tour happening, which we're all meeting by the piano, and after this, just want to thank Robin from Elevated HR. Can you say hello and wave your hands? So if you want from Elevated HR, go to you over there. I also want to thank Hangar Cat Films, Sebastian over there, who's recording this. And other than that, thanks again, Tony, and Melrose Gang, and Mustard Seed. So we'll see you next time.